in the finance industry for almost 32, 33 years now. I did my mathematics, physics, and statistics graduation from Lucknow University. That was way back in 1986. In 1988, I completed my master's in statistics. And after that, I went into, you know, banking. I worked with various banks. I was in the banking industry for almost 18 years. And when I quit the banking industry, that was in 2007, which was to explore the market and to explore myself and my capabilities and put that to better use for the society, for the people who were coming to me for advice. Like my last, I was with State Bank of India that time. So in State Bank of India, I was the branch manager, and my customers would come to me and they would ask me that, okay, Chaitali ma'am, where do I put my 5 lakh rupees, which I have additional? Now, being with the bank, I had the restriction of telling them where they could invest, because I could not be totally unbiased in giving what my advice was, what the correct advice was. I had to only sell SBI mutual funds and the company, you know, the products which we had at that point of time in 2007. So I thought for myself that if I do step out of the bank and start doing something of my own, where with my experience, I would be able to give better advice to the clients, to the people who are having faith in my advice and coming to me, it would serve the purpose better. So to that extent, I mean, that was my driving force. And I stepped out, and you will not believe, there was not even a single day when I regretted that decision. It has been the best decision of my life, to be able to give value and to be able to deliver something which is, you know, much beyond just monetary terms. What I was able to do was give financial wellness to my clients, and that was my calling, you know, that was what I am very passionate about. And I will come to that, that you all also need to recognize your passion before you start your journey into, you know, into this profession or into, you know, a particular niche wherever you're wanting to work in. So recognizing that passion along with, you know, being ready with all the educational qualification, your certifications and your graduations, all that put together is what, you know, makes you ready to be able to, you know, step out and be ready for the career which you have chosen for yourself. So with that, I think we can, you know, start off on the presentation. So shall I share my screen now? I'll just start sharing the screen. Okay, so there are, you know, how many of you are there now currently? About 144 of you. Okay, so you know, all of you are youngsters. You all are, you know, must be so excited to start on your this journey. And what I'm trying to do is just give you a little, you know, macro view about what is it you are, you know, trying to achieve. What is it you are diving into? It is a huge area the industry is very, very large. The industry is very, very layered. And it will really depend upon, you know, how you recognize what you are wanting to do for yourself and what is suitable for you. So if we look at, you know, the overall, what the finance industry holds for you and holds for a person who is interested in getting into this particular industry, it could be, you know, asset management, it could be corporate finance. There are actuarial risk managers also. Derivative structuring could be one area. You could become a hedge fund manager, or you could get into, you know, investment banking. Now, I'll just give two lines about each of these. If you look at asset management, it is nothing but a person or a manager who is managing the client's asset. It is not your asset you're managing. You will be managing somebody else's, a client's assets, which is according to their investment preferences and their goals. And you will also be looking at and keeping in mind their risk profile. And once you have created the portfolio, you will be actively managing it throughout the year. To be able to work in asset management, you should be very much aware of what the market trends are, what, you know, people are doing, where the opportunities lie going forward. So it has to be a very, very holistic knowledge and keeping abreast of what's happening in the world. If we come to, you know, corporate finance, then under corporate finance, you could be working with, working with the finances of a particular company, where you will have to manage the debt, how the company is going to raise their finances, whether it should be by way of, you know, debt, or whether it should be by way of, equity. And you will have to work with a lot of data and do a lot of analysis of the financial results. So it is basically, you know, working with huge amount of numbers and keeping track of in which direction the company is going, keeping track of that. In all of this, they also keep you have to be aware of, about the risk management of as part of corporate finance as well. If we look at actuarial risk management, it is mostly, you know, open to the insurance industry. And what they do is they deal with the measurement and management of risks and uncertainty, because insurance is nothing but insuring a person from happening of an uncertain event. What are the possibility of that uncertain event happening? What could be the loss? And therefore, how much premium should be charged from that person to cover that particular, you know, risk? That is what, you know, is the heart of the insurance industry. So the actuarial manager or the actuarial department is basically the heart of the whole of the insurance industry. If you look at derivatives, derivative structure is nothing but it's basically a contract which it derives its value from some underlying, you know, entity. And that entity could be an index, it could be an asset, it could also be maybe, you know, interest rate. So it is a very complex and very challenging area under derivative structuring. What does a hedge manager do? So you must have, you know, read about, you know, hedge fund managers. So a manager would be somebody who is managing and he's making some investments. And the decisions are driven by his understanding of the market. So he oversees the day-to-day, you know, operations as well. And the purpose of the hedge fund manager is nothing but generating gains for the client. And but before you become a hedge fund manager, you can actually start off as a hedge fund analyst. And typically a hedge fund manager has a number of analysts working under him. So your starting point would not become, you know, not directly be a hedge fund manager. You have to start off at the analyst level and then show your expertise and grow up to be a hedge fund manager. The last piece here, which we are looking at, would be the investment banking. And investment bankers are basically, you know, they are connectors. They are the middlemen, or you can call them the sales agent, who are connecting the businesses who need to raise some capital, raise some money from the market, and connecting them to the investors who have the money and they are ready to provide that money to these companies who want to raise capital. And the investment banker does nothing but, you know, connect these two. And therefore, there has to be, you know, the interpersonal skills, and you have to be, you know, be good at, you know, talking, and to be able to, you know, convey your thoughts. Very good communication skills are needed. In fact, communication skills are needed for a number of these. I would say, other than actuarial, hedge fund manager, you need excellent communication skill. Investment banking, you need communication skills. Asset management, you need communication skill, as well as, you know, understanding the client's need. Corporate finance, not so much, and actuarial also not so much. But most of it in finance, I would say, if there are two qualities which are absolutely critical to become a success, one is to be able to, you know, be comfortable with numbers. The second top quality is to be having a analytical mind. If you do not have these two, you will not be able to survive in the finance industry. The third, often regarded very important, is your communication skills and your interpersonal relation skills. That is also very, very, it is much needed, because all said and done, we, you know, work with people. You need to have people skills. Let's look at what a job description of a. So these were the six, you know, main areas we'll be delving into. And in the following slides, we will look more into what, you know, each of these areas, what it comprises of, what are the kind of skills you should have, what is the kind of, you know, education you should have, whether any additional, you know, certification is required by you or not. So this is what we are going to talk about in the following slides. So let's look at what a, you know, asset manager's job description is. So like I had already mentioned, so the client's assets are, you know, managed by you, by the asset manager, and it has to keep in mind the risk, the goals, what are the preferences of, you know, of the client to be able to deliver to the client. One thing as an asset manager you have to keep in mind is success is defined by the client, not by you. So something what you decide is very good or is successful may not be seen by the client as success. So please be very clear about what the client wants and try to deliver that, because only then in the client's eyes you will be successful. So the client needs and what they want and what their specific, you know, need is what should be the driving force for you to be able to do what the client wants from you as the asset manager. You also have to, you know, develop and maintain and organize the client portfolios. You have to be, you know, abreast of what's happening in the market. You have to study the market trends, maximizing the profit. That is your main purpose. And you also have to go on identifying the investment opportunities if something is opening up. Coordinates with property managers, brokers. So you also have to, you know, go on talking to and having good relationship and keeping networking with people of different areas so that you can deliver to the client. So you have to have a lot of these, you know, networking skills where you're talking to brokers, third parties, you know, the other managers as well. You have to, of course, be in, you know, constant touch with clients and maintain the relationship as well, along with, you know, just delivery of what they want from you. If you look at the salary, typically entry level salary in the US would be about 50,000 per annum, US dollar. In India, it's about 3 lakhs per annum. That would be a entry level with something like a MBA finance or something like that. So you are absolutely, you know, zero on experience. So this is where you would start off. Who would be hiring you? Typically, it is the asset management companies. Banks will be hiring you. Some insurance companies could also hire you because they also manage the portfolios of the clients who are having investment-driven insurances with them. You could also work for the mutual fund industry. They also have managers who are doing the management of the funds. What are the kind of qualifications, the skills you would be requiring? Of course, you'll be needing the bachelor's degree, which is in finance. It could also be business with a specific, you know, with particular this thing in finance or something, you know, related field. In this industry, it is seen that an MBA is preferred because a person is supposed to have skills beyond just crunching numbers. So an MBA gives that holistic, you know, rounding up of your personality, which makes you ready to be an asset manager. If you have 3 years of successful asset management experience, then you will be able to do well and grow up to be having a good career in this. There are ample opportunities, specifically here in India. There are huge number of, you know, need for talented asset managers. You have to be very comfortable with numbers. You have to be very comfortable with, you know, drawing tables, drawing inferences, and using various, you know, methods and tools to able to make your charts and to be able to make your future predictions. Like I mentioned, analytical and strategically minded is very, very important. You also have to be a skilled negotiator because you need to do a lot of talking with people, not only the clients, but also the within the industry, a lot of other third parties as well. You absolutely have to be organized and very, very detail oriented. In finance, one thing you cannot afford to do is make mistakes. You have to double check, triple check, 10 times you have to check your numbers. You cannot be giving wrong numbers or wrong mistakes or careless mistakes is absolutely a no-no in this industry. You cannot be, you know, you will not be, you'll not last long if you are careless with your numbers. Your communication skill has to be good, both written as well as oral. So this is what, you know, the skills and all would be required to be a good and successful asset manager. Now let's look at what corporate finance, requirements, what does he do, or he or she, what is the kind of responsibility a corporate finance manager has? So they have to be working obviously with clients at senior levels, because corporate means it is, you know, we are talking about the company level. And whenever you're talking about the company level, you are straight away interacting with the senior management. And your main direction will be coming from the senior management as to what they want. You have to be, you know, you'll be advising on how to meet the targets, create an investment capital, generating finance from shares and loans, whether you know you have to have a debt oriented capital to be taken from the market, or whether they should be floating some equity to raise capital from the market. So that is a very, very important decision. And that is where you come in, that you will be deciding for the company what would be best for that particular company and for that particular year where they are. Then, of course, you have to be, analyzing, interpreting numerical information. You will be, working with a lot of Excel sheets. You'll be working with a lot of, predictions for the future. You also have to look at industry level, what others are doing. That also is a must to be able to, survive in corporate finance. So your eyes and your ears, everything has to be very, very open. And you will be using a lot of financial modeling so that you can predict what the outcomes would be, where, if we do this, where the company will stand. If we do B, how the balance sheet will look, 5 years, 10 years down the line. If we go for option C, how does the balance sheet look? Maybe, 5 years, 10 years down the line. So it's all about, building up scenarios with various, interpretations. Here you will see that the salary would be starting at about, $100,000 in the US. And in India, the starting salary would be somewhere around 6 lakhs per annum. The opportunities would typically be in banks, in broker houses, insurance companies, consulting firms, also take corporate managers. Large corporate houses will be having their own corporate finance department, and you could start off there as well. So suppose, you start off at a lower level and you show keenness and you show diligence, then you can, immediately rise up much fast within that organization. What are the qualifications and skills a typical corporate finance person would be requiring? Should have, of course, good exposure in trade finance. Fund management has to be, absolutely under control. You should be able to, do good coordination and talking and having the hierarchy. You should be knowing with banks, forex, and with hedging. Your computing skills has to be excellent. You should be comfortable with large volume of numerical data. That I think, being you all are studying finance, you already know that. But finally, when you are in the work arena, and you get down to a practical working area, you will see that the numbers are absolutely mind-boggling. And you will not get clean data what you get in a classroom. When your professors are giving you data, it is absolutely clean and it has been custom made and formatted for you. When you are in the real world, the world will not be so plastic, it will not be so organized. You will have copious amount of data. It will be for you to take that data, see what is relevant, take it up, clean it up, and put it in a format which makes sense. All that has to be done by you. You will be, from start to finish, you will be responsible for doing the whole work. So it is not, there won't be anyone holding your hand and giving you, clean data for you to work on. So this is a very, I would say a classroom is a very antiseptic environment to work on. But once you get out onto the world, it would be, it would be mayhem, and you have to survive all of that. So you have to be very strong and, totally dedicated and totally passionate about, what you are doing. You should not leave it, midway and say that, okay, this is not working, and you put up your hands. That will just not do. Okay, so coming to experience, you need to have at least, So you cannot straight away, get into corporate finance. Probably you'll have to work at lower levels and have some experience working in an organization and get some corporate experience working in a professional, environment for 4 to 8 years. Only after that you will get into, because this is slightly, higher level. So it's not too many people would be taken absolutely into corporate finance directly. You need to have some work experience. Then if you look at education, I would say, therefore, because they are looking at work experience, so doing an MBA is good, because typically for getting into an MBA also you need about 2 years of experience. So you do your graduation, you do 2 years of work experience, get an MBA, then probably you are ready to get into corporate finance. Just give me 1 minute, I'll have a sip of water. The next area we are looking at is actuarial science, and which is basically, the risk management for the insurance industry, basically. That is what is called the actuarial sciences. So here you would be requiring a bachelor's degree, again, either in IT or some related field. An MBA or an MS is preferred, because you will not be able to get straight away into a very entry level. Because actuarial, even the number of papers is pretty high. You have to clear 15 levels in this. So it requires a lot of, long-term commitment from your side if you at all decide to get into actuary business. Hands-on experience is very much required, because you will be working on systems which are, particularly made for the insurance industries. So all of that which in the 15 levels which I talked to you about, while you are doing that, you will have ample experience of working on those structures and how you will how to do the prediction for and calculate the premiums for any particular risk. All Microsoft tools, of course, the project, the PowerPoint, Excel, Visio, all of this will be very much required. You have to have very good written and verbal communication, because you will be writing the reports yourself and you'll have to do the presentation. And here, when I say client presentation, the client is nothing but your insurance company. That is your client. It is not an outsider. You from the actuarial department will be presenting to your company, to the people who are possibly in marketing or who are in product development. So the product development department will be coming to you with a proposal that this is a new product we are working on, and we want you to calculate what the risk premium will be. Then you start working on it, and then you do the presentation to the product department. They would be your client. It is not an outsider. Your project management skills, your leadership skills, teamwork, I would say teamwork is really needed everywhere. None of it, wherever you're working, you have to work in a team and you have to get along, with others. And everyone is not the same. There will be ups and downs. There'll be some people you are uncomfortable with. There'll be some people who are overbearing. There'll be some people who are super efficient and super cocky and aggressive. You have to work with all of them. So other than the skills which you are developing now and which you are learning, the academic, skills which you are learning in the classroom, I would say you have to get ready for the people skills as well, because none of this is of any use if you cannot handle the people who are around you. And you have to work with bosses, you have to work with colleagues. And after some time, you will also have some juniors working under you. So all the three levels, the people above you, the people around you, as well as the people working under you, you have to have the managing skills of managing these people. The opportunities would be only in the insurance companies mostly. And here it could be, life insurance, and it could be, non-life insurance as well. The median salary here, if you're looking at the US market, would be about $50,000 per annum. And as and when you become more and more senior, it more than doubles to $130,000 for a person. And by that time, you would have spent about, 5 to 9 years in that particular insurance industry. In India, we start off with about 3.5 lakh per annum, and an average actuarial manager these days is earning about 9 to 10 lakhs. That is the kind of salary you can look at. What are the kind of qualifications which would be required if at all you are looking at actuarial as your calling? You need to have at least, before you start working, 3 to 4 actuarial papers you have to clear. Then you can start off as an assistant manager. And once you have done, out of the 15, you have done 7 to 8 actuarial papers, you can actually become a deputy manager. So you need not wait for clearing all the 15 papers before you start working. Once you clear a couple of them, 3 to 4, you can get into the industry, and rest of the papers you have to do while you are working. So that is also a challenge, because you have to work and do your responsibilities, because they'll be paying you a salary. So that responsibility, and you have to come back home, and in the night you have to study as well. So what I'm trying to say is, life till now has been pretty easy for all of you, because you have only a single purpose, which is studying. Now, when you get out onto the world of work and getting into the job market, you will see that life will be very difficult, because as soon as somebody starts paying you a salary, their expectations are very, very high. So you have to start delivering. And if your boss or your company or your firm is not happy with your work, then you could again be out on the road. So please take your job very, very seriously. Give it your 100%, and don't only when you are convinced that this is not made for you, or you're not suitable for that job, only then you leave. But then have a plan B in place, that okay, if this is not suitable, what would be suitable for me? And only then quit. So do not quit in a huff. Have something else in mind. Have your plan B in place. Then you quit your job, because jobs are not easy today. So you should not take hasty decisions as well. Okay, so back to this. You should be comfortable with coding, building models, documentation. Again, verbal and written communication has to be there. You should be absolutely comfortable with modeling and statistics. You'll be using a lot of statistics here in actuarial science. Analyzing actuarial problems in terms of modeling. And there would be a lot of products which will be discussed and which will be developed while you are working, and this is nothing which is old and something which you can fall back on. It could be new and challenging as well, and you have to go on working on those calculations and looking at a new product from all angles and seeing where the risk could come from and factoring all that into your model, so that you can come up with the right insurance premium. So that is what an actuarial risk manager does. Next, we come on to the derivative structuring. And as I said, derivatives was a little complex area where you are working with a contract where there is something else. The value is getting derived from something else, which is there's an underlying another entity. So while you're working on derivatives, you have to work on pricing models. You have to work with risk models as well as trade trading. You also will be doing a lot of market research. Your computation skills has to be absolutely fantastic, up to the mark. You have to maintain a lot of databases. You also have to do a lot of discussion with the investors, hedge fund managers, the salespeople, and the quantitative analysis people, because it is all a give and take. And if you get into derivative at all, you will have opportunities in banks, in investment banks, broker dealers, as well as pension funds also use a lot of derivatives in their portfolios. So you could be working with them as well. If you look at derivative structuring, then you have to have, as far as qualification and skill is concerned, you have to have an analytical mind. Definitely domain knowledge is a must. You should be able to identify and seize opportunities. What are the kind of salaries these people draw? It starts off typically with a $50,000 per annum US dollar, and it really goes up sizable to about $133,000, which is the average $133,000 US dollar in the United States of America. If you look at the Indian counterpart, you would typically be, with a 3 to 4 year experience, you will be drawing about 8-9 lakh per annum on an average. I think this is the last piece, which is the investment banking. This is, where a typical investment banker would be issuing debt and raising equity and raising capital for the client. He provides expertise on M&A, will be working extensively on mergers and acquisition. It gets investors for an IPO as well. Again, here you have to work with financial models. You have to value debt and equity. You have to help in investing and financial decisions of the client companies. Reporting has to be done. Presentations have to be done. And all of this, you have to do the talking. So it's not only the presentation skills, you have to do the talking as well. And you should be able to convey your thoughts clearly. Your communication skill has to be, pretty good. You have to be abreast about the product, the market situation, and the industry where you're working with. Your qualification and skills here would be, again, these are very common skills, as you can see, analytical and technical abilities, judgment and problem-solving skills, academic credentials, of course, you need to have. And if you have, you need to have good verbal and communication skills written in as well. And you typically in an investment banking area, you will be working in a team. It is not a lone single person working. So you should be able to work as a team. There'll be a lot of your teammates as well, and you will have a team manager who will be managing a couple of you, maybe 7-8 of you, under him. Typically, they do prefer 2 to 4 years of experience in an investment banking. And if you complete your MBA, then it is good because you will be having the work experience as well. You can, in India, about 10 lakh per annum is the salary. The hedge fund manager. Here, the hedge fund manager is nothing but who's managing a huge amount of, corpus on behalf of clients. These are the absolute, the maverick, the people you are talking. You'll be reading about some hedge fund managers, they become stars, they become very famous. It all depends on what kind of, returns you are able to generate for your portfolio. So they literally are, if you manage it well, you can actually, become a absolutely, 5-star hedge fund manager. It's a very lucrative, but also quite exacting. It needs a lot of your time and your effort and a lot of your hard work. So you need to have critical thinking skills and you have to have the ability to analyze the market trends, investment data. You need to analyze that, so that your clients' portfolios are successful. Again, here communication skills comes in. Ability to manage portfolios is absolutely essential, because you have to grow their money. You cannot be making losses. You cannot be doing, you know, wrong bets. You need to have very strong background in accounting principles. Your number crunching should be flawless. You have to also have good networking and PR skills, because without this, public relations, you cannot become a good hedge fund manager. You have to have a total network of people whom you talk to, because it is all about information. Hedge fund manager can only deliver if he has got good information. So you have to have your ear to the ground, talk to people, have good networking, so that you can apply that knowledge to the portfolios which you are managing. It is an absolutely demanding career, being a hedge fund manager. You have to be ready to put in very long hours. You have to have a passion for profitability. Otherwise, you will not be able to survive here. What are the qualifications? You have to, of course, have a bachelor's degree in finance or accounting. Some positions do require master's degree as well. If you are a certified public accountant or some national exams you have passed, or if you are a CA, then it becomes an additional, advantage to be able to do a manager fund. They can, there are also hedge fund association is there, where you can actually become a member, try to follow a few famous hedge funds, see what they are doing, how they operate. You will get a feel of what a particular, this particular area requires as skill. You can start off as a hedge fund analyst, which will be typically the entry level. And you can start off with a 4 lakh per annum, which is about in India. And once you become, experienced, maybe after a couple of years, you can be earning in India about 20 to 80 lakh per annum. And if you are in the US, that its equivalent would be about $150,000 US. So as you can see, in terms of, hierarchy, these salaries are extremely, extremely high. And it is not, it is a pinnacle, I would say. But to be able to reach this pinnacle, it requires a lot of hard work, a lot of commitment on your part. You cannot be doing this half-heartedly. If you are ready to, become a hedge fund manager, you have to put in heart and soul into this. And you have to be not 100, but 110% committed to this. Only then you will be able to, actually earn this kind of a salary. If you can do your CFA or your FRM, then it would be very good. Once you have completed your, MBA finance here, look at some of these, certifications which would come in useful for you. You could look at, CISA, you could look at CRFM. Even production and inventory management is a good combination to have along with a finance degree. You could also complete your project management PMP certification. The PMP certification can be done online. Try to get that, or you can even appear for the chartered accountants. Depending on what your interest is, which area you are wanting to identify for yourself, some of these additional certifications would come in very, very useful. This is the next piece I would be, presenting to you. Because we are in, 2020, we are absolutely, in a very challenging times, where you all must have seen that we are going, along with the health crisis, we are also undergoing a financial crisis. And therefore, the companies, the units, most of the factories have stopped working. Some of the industry, like airline industry or the tourism industry, hospitality industry, all of them are very, very badly affected. Now, therefore, today the world we are seeing is very, very different to what it was last year in June. June of 19, nobody would have dreamt that this is where we will be standing today in June of 2020. The World Economic Outlook has already predicted, and this was way back in April. If you look at the prediction in June, they haven't come out with a prediction yet, but they said that the GDP, the global GDP, is going to contract by 3%. But this was the what their calculation was in April. I think the situation has become much worse than what it was in April. So we could be looking at, you know, maybe a 5 to 7% contraction in the global GDP going forward. You would also, looking around, looking at your parents, looking at, you know, people around you who are working, you must have realized that organizations have lost huge amount of revenues in the last 3 months itself. And the situation is not turning better immediately. It is still unfolding. Still, things are very, very uncertain. None of the country in the whole world has been able to manage COVID-19 in such a way where they can be said that they have successfully, you know, controlled it. It's all still a very, very, you know, experimental basis. Some are doing well, some not so well, but everyone is just struggling. Global unemployment has gone up to, you know, 190 million people are out of jobs. And that is a huge blow. Income loss has been there for about, you know, $3.4 trillion. Now that's a huge, huge amount. So we are talking about income loss, we are looking at unemployment. And if you look at the informal economy, people who are unskilled workers, there is a huge 1.6 billion people have lost their livelihood. Now, therefore, we are looking at a very, very sad world today. And you have to be mentally and physically prepared in this very, very challenging times. So do not be in a, you know, it's not a rosy world you are stepping out to. That's what I'm trying to say. The challenges are there. It's a tough, tough world. And there will be, you know, huge amount of, you know, headwinds which you will be facing going forward. You must have seen that there are many companies who are cutting jobs and cutting salaries. You must have heard people who are saying that their, you know, 20% of their salary has been cut. Some people have actually lost their jobs as well. Now, if there is a sizable amount of experienced workforce which is sitting on the side today, you have to compete with those people to be able to get a job. And that is, again, you know, a little daunting, if not anything. Because you, as fresh graduate, you are actually competing with these experienced people who are today out of jobs. And because of their desperation, they are even ready to take a salary cut. Earlier, they may be having a package of 12 lakh. Today, they will do the same work even at 8 lakh rupees and they will take up that job. So it becomes, you know, very, very tough for you as well going forward. What are you going to do? I would say preparing yourself mentally and physically, like I said, is the right way to be able to be ready for very, very tough times which you are going to face going forward, in specifically in today's, you know, when the economy is shrinking. So I would say these are a few points I thought of which will help you in deciding what you need to do going forward. So the first and foremost thing is you need to evaluate what your own skills are, where do your expertise lie, and with that, sit with my presentation and find out which area would be, which branch of finance would be good for you, and start preparing for that particular branch. Then I would also say, look for internship, because all said and done, book knowledge and only academic knowledge is not going to serve any purpose. It is good, you need to have that, but along with it, you need to have practical work experience. You need to get your hands dirty. No gardener will become a successful gardener unless he gets his hand into the mud and plants a few seeds. You need to get your hands dirty. So you have to get your work experience. You start your internship, even at a minimal pay or absolutely no wages also. That also you take it, because today you need the experience more than anything. So please be ready to work for zero salary also, because you will be getting experience. So if any company is ready to take you on, just say yes and get on and, you know, try to get some work experience. I would also say, when you're applying for jobs, do not be very picky and choosy that I'm going to apply to only 10 jobs or 15 jobs. Nothing like this. Jobs are very tough. You have to apply to at least 100 jobs. Then you will be able to land something. And do not be, you know, miserly when you're applying. Please just go on applying left, right, and center. It is up to them to call you or not. You do not decide whether you are apt for, you know, that particular job or not. From your mind, you be confident and go on applying. At least 100 jobs needs to be applied for in today's scenario. Consider adding to your quality. Now, if you do not get a job, what do? Do not sit at home. Please add to your qualification by getting some degree or a certification. Keep on learning. Because one thing I've realized is that learning has got no end, and learning has got nothing to do with age. You can do your learning at any age, and whatever knowledge you gain will come in useful in some form or the other in your work area, and you'll be able to apply. Like I, for myself, I went back to the university after 30 years of, you know, graduating out of college. I told you I did my statistics, MSc in statistics, way back in 1988. Then in 2017, I went back to college and I did my master's in global finance. And I actually sat in the class, did the classes, learned from the professors, and it was such an enriching experience. And whatever knowledge I gained, I was a class of 2018 in HKUST and NYU Stern. And if I look at what I gained out of, you know, NYU Stern, I would say, I was very, very like impressed with one of our professors. He was our valuation professor, Ashwa Damodaran. And what he said, that you cannot learn unless you make mistakes. So do not, you know, stop yourself from learning. Keep on learning, make mistakes, no problem, because that you will be able to, you know, turn it into a success. And if we look at investing, success in investing, it comes not from being right, but from being wrong less often than everyone else. So what he's also trying to say is, you will be making mistakes, but never stop learning from those mistakes. The more you make mistakes, the more your learning is. So keep on doing. Do not, once you make a mistake, do not, do not stop working, and do not, stop experimenting. If experiment one fails, no problem. You go on to experiment two, go on to experiment three. But in all those failures, keep a log of what you're learning from each of those experiences. So do that. Do not consider any job lowly. If you just get one, anyone who's offering you a job, just go on, put in your 100%, hold on to it. If not anything else, you will learn tenacity by, you know, hanging on to that job. Even if you do not like it initially, just, you know, because life is not very easy. You cannot be, you know, taking up a job and within 6 months say, okay, this is not fitting me. I don't like the environment. I don't like the people working in this organization. I'll leave. Do not do that, because getting another opportunity would be very, very difficult. And lastly, my advice would be, you should be hardworking, but do not be like a donkey hardworking. Be a smart, hardworking person. That is what is required in today's world. Be very diligent in your work. Be ethical. Oh my God, we are in finance. I had mentioned two main characteristics, but to be able to enter into finance, your entry card is you being ethical. You have to be ethical. You cannot be coming into finance and think that you will, double cross people and you'll get away with, bungling your money. You cannot be doing that. You have to be 110% ethical in whatever you are dealing with, whatever numbers, whatever money you are dealing with. And of course, you need to be passionate. Now, to be successful, you need to love what you do. And that love comes only from passion. And only if you're passionate about what you do, you love your job. And then it does not remain a job. Then it will become, a picnic for you. Like for me, Azuke work, what I do, it is total picnic for me. I don't consider it as at work. I work 365 days, absolutely. I do not take any break. And I just love doing that. Therefore, it's such a high for me. And that is where, my interest lies, my passion is. And I just want to deliver, value to all the people who are out there, who are my clients. So with that, we come to, the end of the presentation. And I hope you have a few, things which you can carry away from this. I will just look at if you have any questions here. So we have a question here that what are the other things we can do if you are looking at, investment banking. So like I had mentioned, if you are, if you want to get into investment banking, typically you would be working, with clients where you are raising money for them. So that is what, the main investment banking area is. You will also get opportunity to work with something like a KPMG or the Big Four. Additional credentials, I would say you could look at, a CFA would be good. You could look at a CFA if you are wanting to, get into investment banking. I'm ready for any other questions. You can just type it out for me. Mayur says, thank you. It was a great session. Thank you, Mayur. It was lovely talking to you. Although I really do not like, talking by myself. I would have loved to see all your faces. And I don't know whether it's possible or not. If I can see your faces, it would be fantastic. If you want to, you can request for unmuting yourself and ask a question also if you want.
Feel free to leave your questions on the chat. Yes. Renuka says, good session. If I want to learn, Mayur says, if I want to learn a command on company analysis, from where I want to start? See, the best way to do a company analysis, I would say, is you can, you know, start doing stock analysis. Read the balance sheets of the companies which are listed. Learning from the balance sheet and then, you know, applying what the inferences from the balance sheet onto how the stock price is doing. That is a great way to learn, I have seen. So you will have data. You can go either to, you know, investing.com or Money Control. You can get the balance sheets of all these companies which are listed. That would be your starting point to actually, you know, see how to do a company analysis. Any other question? Kimpi says, I want to get in the field of corporate finance, but I don't have any experience yet. How can I move towards that? See, corporate finance is a little, it's not easy, I would say. So possibly what you could do is look up for some material which is in corporate finance. You could also, which is this, you can look at corporate finance courses in Coursera. Try to do that. Some of it is free of charge. Some of it is very, you know, small amount payable. Do some of those courses. And today when you are, you know, while you're looking for a job, looking for what next to do, whether you should go for an MBA, beyond MBA, any other certification or degree, that is the time when you can actually, you know, do a lot of courses from Coursera. They will also give you a certification. So Shilpi, I would advise, do some corporate finance small courses from Coursera. Oh, you are already doing. Excellent. That will actually give you an idea whether you are, you know, having a penchant for it or not. If you are interested, I can share some, you know, corporate finance material also with you. I have some corporate finance material. I'm ready for any other question if anybody else has. Okay, there does not seem to be any more questions coming in. So I think we can, you know, close this session today. Thank you very much, all of you. It has been, you know, great having you all come in and join and give, you know, almost an hour and a half from of your time. And I wish you all the best. Just try to, you know, try to find where your passion lies. Be absolutely, you know, very true to whatever you're doing. Give it your full heart and soul. I'm sure all of you will be able to make a success of your life. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
Bye.